we should go see him, Beth. Dr. Berger.
What?
I thought we could all go and see him together.
Why?
He thinks it's a good idea.
Oh, he thinks it's a good idea? What does he know about me, about this family? I've never even met him.
Exactly, that's the point.
Wouldn't it be easier if we all talked about it in the open?
About what? What are we going to talk about? Don't try to change me, Calvin. I don't want any more changes in my life. For God's sake, hasn't enough happened? Let's just hold on to what we've got.
Darling, that is what this is for. Maybe you'll get a surprise.
I don't want any surprises.
That's a scene from Ordinary People with Mary Tyler Moore and Donald Sutherland arguing about whether they should see a psychiatrist to help them solve their family problems in Ordinary People. One of five new movies we'll be reviewing this week on Sneak Previews, a show where two film critics talk about and sometimes argue about the new movies in town. Across the aisle from me, Roger Ebert, film critic of the Chicago Sun-Times. Welcome back to the balcony, Roger.
Thank you, Gene. This is Gene Siskel, film critic of the Chicago Tribune.
Our next movie is about a subject that Hollywood has avoided for a long time, the American family. That's been changing lately, fortunately. First, there was Kramer versus Kramer, last year's Oscar-winning Best Picture. Later in the show, we're going to be talking about Ordinary People. Now we have The Great Santini, an excellent portrait of a family that battles together and stays together. The center of the family is the father, played by Robert Duvall, a Marine colonel who rides roughshod over his children, particularly his oldest son. Here he takes on the boy in a vicious game of one-on-one basketball. The father has never lost one of these games, ever.
Hey!
99! Don't worry, Colonel, you can always get a disability pension.
Don't goad him, Ben. Don't goad him now. Come on, just play.
Last shot of the game, Jocko. Give up? Ha-ha.
Stay close, Ben. Now watch him.
What is Fanny, Ben?
It is I, the great Ventini.
You know, Dad, not one of us has ever beaten you in a single game. Not checkers, not dominoes, not softball, nothing.
Watch it, Ben. He's getting that look.
Come on over here. Come on over here to Daddy Boy. Come
all
on.
Over.
Get out of here before I knock every freckle off your face.
That's mean.
Wasn't that great?
Come on, Jocko. You got to win by two baskets.
He said one.
I changed my mind. Let's go.
Now, you're not going to cheat the boy out of his victory. Come on, be a good sport.
Who the hell asked you anything?
Don't you talk to me like that. No, you won't. Now, he beat you, and it was beautiful.
Lily, you better get in the house before I kick your butt.
It was just beautiful.
No, I mean it. Come on, let's go. Hurry, come on.
Touch that ball.
You better move, woman.
All right.
Come on, let's go. Come on.
That's pretty brutal, but there is a core of caring for his children that's deep inside Robert Duvall. He loves his kids, but his military role has taught him to keep his emotions bottled up. Now watch what happens in this scene when Duvall wakes up his son at 4 a.m. to give him a birthday present.
What is it? It's a training bra. Open it. I've been saving it for you for 18 years. Looks good. That was my first. I wore it in WW2 when I flew with the Cobras.
It's great, Dad. Thanks.
Don't make them like that anymore. It's part of the old Corps. You're 18, Ben. I woke up thinking about the day you were born. I was on a hop. And all I heard when I landed was that your mother was in a hospital. So I went crazy. I hit 100 miles an hour getting there with the MPs chasing me. Knocking nurses out of the way, running over the small children, crashing into patients on the way to the operating room. And you're screaming your head off. And I'm banging on the window trying to get your attention, bragging to everybody who'd listen that the toughest little fighter pilot in the world had been born. Then I ran down to see how your mother was, expecting her to look like some hell after punching you out of her system. Hell, she was sitting up, looking prettier than I'd ever seen her. That was 18 years ago. 18 years ago today. I was 23.
That's a beautiful monologue there. The Great Santini is not much more than a character study, but what a character. At first, like his children, we want to strangle Robert Duvall. Then we begin to appreciate the fact that he does care about his kids. He's caught in a tight place between his heart and his training. Needless to say, this is an excellent film for a family to see together and really discuss how they feel about this extremely strong father. I think you're going to have mixed feelings.
I'm in total agreement with you. I think this is a terrific picture for everybody to see. I think it's very interesting that only now is it going into release around the country. I think it's opened in about 12 cities where it's doing very well. But this is a picture that after it first bombed in a couple of test markets in the South, the studio pulled off the market. They set on it. They were afraid to release it. They sold it to airplanes. They sold it to pay cable systems. They know how to sell exploitation pictures. They know how to sell multi-million dollar space epics. But get a nice little human drama that's about people, and they're baffled by it. Who would ever want to see this?
Well, you see, I think that's because the movie industry right now is playing up to kids, teenagers. Most movies are made for teenagers. Those are the ones that make the big hits, Grease, Star Wars, that kind of picture, Blue Lagoon. I think that the response to this film from the American public is really saying that the American public wants adult films, too. You know, adults want to go to the movies, too. And this film is really drawing families and adults in particular. We are starved for stories about older people. And I think that's what, we have very mixed feelings about the Robert Duvall character, but we hunger for this kind of character so much, we're drawn to this guy. Fascinating.
You know, they talk about family films that are for kids of all ages. This is a family film for adults of all ages, including mature kids.
Good phrase.
If you can follow that. As a matter of fact, I think The Great Santini is one of the best pictures of the year. And we're going to move on now to another movie that I think is also one of the year's best. So we're on a hot streak. This movie is Ordinary People, Robert Redford's first film as a director. Redford doesn't appear in this picture, but he does a more than capable job behind the camera. Ordinary People tells a story of love, pain, and self-deception in the upper-middle-class suburban family that it's about. Before the movie opens, one of the family's two sons has been killed in a boating accident. Now the survivors have to find a way to live together without him. Mary Tyler Moore plays the deeply troubled mother, and in this scene, she's angry because her one surviving son has quit the high school swimming team. He's done it months ago, and he hasn't even told her.
It's really important to try to hurt me, isn't it?
Don't you have that backwards?
Oh? And how do I hurt you? By embarrassing you in front of a friend? Poor Beth, she has no idea what her son is up to. He lies and she believes every word of it.
I didn't lie.
You did. You lied every time you came into this house at 6:30. If it's starting all over again, the lying, the covering up, the disappearing for hours, I will not stand for it. I can't stand it. I really can't.
Well, don't then. Go to your...
Connie, now, Connie.
The only reason she cares, the only reason is because someone else knew about it first.
Just stop it, Connie.
No, you tell her to stop it. You never tell her a goddamn thing.
Maybe this is how they sit around and talk at the hospital, but we're not at the hospital now.
You never came to the hospital.
Connie,
how do you know about the hospital?
Come to the hospital. Now, you know that she did. She had the flu, and she couldn't come inside, but she came
to
the hospital.
Yeah, well, she wouldn't have had any flu if Buck was in the hospital. She would have come if Buck was in the hospital.
Buck never would have been in the hospital.
That's enough. That is enough.
I won't do it again. I really won't do it.
What in hell has happened?
That was Timothy Hutton as the teenage son. He gives an extraordinary performance in Ordinary People because he doesn't simply get more and more disturbed and tortured the way you might think. He bottoms out, and then he learns once again how to grow and how to love. The changes in his personality are really what this movie is about. That and how his parents feel they ought to react to his emotional problems. His mother is especially uptight about involving a psychiatrist in private family matters.
I know I'm not perfect. And if I can't go around hugging everybody all the time the way you do, then I'm sorry.
I'm not asking you to be perfect. You're missing the point.
I don't want to see any doctors or counselors. I'm me. This is my family. And if we have problems, then we will solve those problems in the privacy of our own home, not by running to some kind of specialist every time something goes wrong.
Are you folks ready to order?
No, could you give me a couple of minutes, please?
Sure.
Running to experts every time something goes wrong. I know you mean well. I want this to be a nice Christmas.
I do, too. I want all of them to be nice Christmases.
We need time together, Calvin, you and I. We have to get away. New Year's. We can spend some time in Houston with my brother and Audrey. You know, play a little golf. Relax. We need time together. Okay?
Okay.
Okay. I love you.
Donald Sutherland plays the father in Ordinary People, and he's very good as a sincere, well-meaning tax attorney who's always thought of his life as orderly, meaningful, and filled with love until his oldest son's death forces him to re-examine his whole world. The best thing about Ordinary People is that it's not just another one of those tragic suburban soap operas where everyone behaves self-destructively. It's a movie that deals intelligently and compassionately with how people can change and grow.
I thought it was a terrific film. You mentioned it's mostly about the kid. For me, I focused on the parents, and mm-hmm. I found the film presenting a very interesting idea, which is these parents are trying to deny that their life has problems. Mm-hmm. They're used to putting on a show in front of their friends and a show, I guess, in front of each other. And what the film is suggesting is an idea that I subscribe to, which is that life is about problems, mm-hmm. about mm-hmm. conquering them, dealing with them, and then creating new ones, because they're going to happen anyway. And that's what this kid experiences. The parents deny it, and then maybe tentatively get some idea about mm-hmm. changing it toward the end.
I think I'm picking up on something here we both agree in, and that's the underlying assumptions that this film has. The woman in this film, Mary Tyler Moore, she wants her house to look right out of the pages of Better Homes and Gardens. Mm-hmm. But unfortunately, everything is in place in her house except for her husband and her son.
Yeah.
They're not in place, and she doesn't like that. But the son, who faces all of these problems, he feels guilt-ridden because his older brother has killed himself and so forth in the boating accident. He's got all of these problems, but he has the resources to look inside of himself, to not just give up. He seeks help. He looks for a psychiatrist. Mm-hmm. He talks to his father. He talks to friends at school. He tries to take control of his life and turn it around. I really like that attitude.
Another thing, this is, again, a film for families to see, mm-hmm. and another adult piece of entertainment, and I just can't underscore that point enough. I think that there's going to be a big response to this film, and I think, and I hope, that the Hollywood executives get the message that adults have $4 to spend on movies, too. Again, directed by Robert Redford, a terrific job his first mm-hmm. time out behind the camera.
Very good film.
Now we step down a little bit in class, a lot of bit in class. Middle-Aged Crazy. It's a film that starts out promisingly as a comedy, I think. Then it makes a big mistake of trying to get serious. It doesn't work at all. It's the story of a man suddenly assaulted by a midlife crisis on his 40th birthday. Bruce Dern is the man, happily married to Anne Margaret. He's a successful businessman, but his 40th birthday really shakes him up, makes him want to reassert his youth, so he fantasizes about changing his clothes and trading in his car. Sort of nice, but you got to wait until Bruce Dern opens his mouth. Then the film becomes very predictable. We're always way ahead of this story. We know that he and Anne Margaret are going to break up, and we suspect they're going to probably get back together again, and we're right. Anne Margaret and Bruce Dern are not a convincing couple. Both seem to be imitating Hollywood's cornball notion of what Texans are supposed to be like. When this film got serious, I just saw a couple of phony characters up there on the screen. They sort of blew this picture, a promising start.
I agree with you about the start. At the beginning of the film, I thought, hey, I like these characters, I like these situations, it's kind of funny, it's nice, light entertainment. Mm-hmm. Then, about halfway through, they flip-flop when Bruce Dern has his big affair with the Texas cheerleader.
Yeah.
And he gets all serious, introspective. What does it all mean? What is my life all about? I liked it when it was middle-aged crazy. I lost interest when it became middle-aged poignant. Two strong yes votes for The Great Santini, with its brilliant performance by Robert Duvall as a father whose emotions are trapped inside his military uniform. We strongly recommend this film. Another strong recommendation is for Robert Redford's Ordinary People, a compelling portrait of the tensions within a troubled suburban family.
So sort of a special week in films this mm-hmm. week. Two excellent films about families. Two films that really, I think, may mark a return to more mature entertainment from Hollywood. And let's hope so, and I hope the public responds to it. I think this is a way of getting rid of some of these kiddie films.
And those two films are Ordinary People and The Great Santini. And you know, Gene, I know there are people who watch television, and they may never go to the movies or only go to a few movies, and they might think all movies are violent or they're for kids or they're stupid. Part of the time they're right.
Yes.
I think I could confidently recommend both of these films.
Two excellent pictures.